Hi, I'm Sarah from SarahTypes.com. Today I'm going to show you how to create your own custom brush for Procreate.
What I did first to make sure this brush is completely custom is just made some brush doodles using some pens that I already had. I just kind of drew something that I thought might be a good shape. So feel free to do whatever you want. And what I did next was just scan them, brought them into Photoshop, and then I just saved them all individually. I made sure there was a little bit more contrast between the black and white, and just saved them out separately so that I can upload them to Procreate using Dropbox. For one example to show transparencies, I layered two brushes and changed the opacity of the top brush. So you're going to want to open Procreate on your iPad Pro and create a new project. And then you're going to want to open your brushes and click on the plus icon on the top right. You'll then have a new untitled brush, which I'm going to rename as Test Brush. So now you see shape and grain. The way this works is shape is basically the outside container of your brush, and whatever goes inside is the fill, and this is where your grain is going to show. So I'm going to upload a shape first by pressing on the shape section, and you can grab them from your Pro library. If you didn't scan any, you can just use one of the shapes they have, or you can upload your own like I showed you. I'm just going to upload it from Dropbox. So once you've selected the brush, it's going to show up in your brush palette, and then you're going to want to select the grain. A good grain to have is something that has a seamless pattern. You can find these online if you don't want to create your own. I just googled seamless textures and tried to find something that would work. So I grabbed one of the textures that is basically just lines across. So I had that uploaded to my Dropbox, and I'm just going to insert that now. Okay, so now I have my shape and my grain. And one thing you can do is you can invert the colors by pressing two fingers. This will toggle between where is going to get the paint. So if you have black in the center, as I do, that's going to be your brush. But if you invert it so it's black around, you're going to get the brush color around where the black is. Basically, full white is full transparent and full black is full color. Anything in between will have a different opacity. Just to exaggerate this tutorial, I'm actually going to invert it so you see the color in the square. It'll just kind of emphasize everything that I'm going to show you in the settings. But you probably want it to be this way, where you have the black brush in the middle. And you can invert the grain as well. And you can also rotate these images, and that gives a different look to the brush as well. You can see it in the preview above just to check to see which looks best. So I'm going to show you what our brush looks like currently. It's not very pretty. It's kind of just a square blob. But we're going to go through all the settings to figure out how to make these look better. I'm also going to change the grain to solid. You can grab that from the Pro library. If you just scroll all the way down, you can see a blank space. So I'm just grabbing that to show you how the brush looks. So the first thing we're going to look at is spacing. This is the gap or the space between each stamp of the brush. Basically just that shape that we uploaded with space in between each of its occurrence.
Streamline makes your strokes more stable and less shaky. So a good example of that is I'm going to go to a brush that I already have in here. This one is by Pigeon Letters. You can see this is really beautiful and fluid. However, if I change the streamline to nothing, let's get rid of this. You can see that it's quite shaky. There. I'll compare it. I'll take this. It's see the difference. Okay, so I'm gonna go back to my test brush and just show you more of the settings. So you usually want some streamline, maybe not all the way, because then it gets a little hard to create what you want to create. Jitter is the distance your shape is offset from itself. The higher values will spread the shape out. So you can see here, when it's nothing, it's smooth, and then jitter will just take it and move it at different points of your brush stroke. So usually, unless you want like a messy brush, you can add a little bit so it gets a little bit of that rough edge. Or if you want a smooth brush, just take that all the way down. So the stroke taper is the beginning and the end where the brush pulls away, where it's at its fullest and where it's at its skinniest. So the start taper, you usually want to be full. You don't want it to start small. So I would just leave that as a full. And then the end, you would usually want it to taper off. These are all tapers, so the opacity is also the how much the brush has opacity. How much the brush tapers off the end as far as the opacity goes. So if it's on full, you're gonna have more opacity, and if it's all the way to none, you're gonna have no opacity, so it's gonna be a complete point. So you do, I usually do want some opacity. And the size is the same thing. So if you have it on max, that's gonna be the most tapered. And if you have it on minimum, you're gonna have like the least. So it's gonna be not really a taper anymore. You'll have some of the gradient, but not that point. So if you move on to shape, this is adjusting the shape we talked about. So not the grain, but what the grain is living in. So a scatter will change the orientation of your brush and it allows for a messy look. So depending on the way your brush is where the scatter will change the brush. And rotation is how your brush reacts to changing direction. And direction of your pen. You can see here how it moves around. So that's just something you have to play with depending on how you want to use your brush. If you turn on randomize, this is going to change the initial shape when your pen hits the page. Whatever that brush stroke looks like is going to change every time your pen hits the page. So I like to keep this off. Azimuth, I'm not really sure if that's how you pronounce it, but this is for brushes where the direction of the brush is the same as the pen. So a good example is a traditional calligraphy pen. So if you're going this way or this way, it definitely changes how your brush stroke is going to look. And so if you turn this on, it allows the shape to follow the angle of the Apple Pencil. So that's great for like black letter calligraphy, for example. In the grain section, we have movement, and this is where it either smears the pattern across the brush stroke or it applies it as like a stamp repeatedly. So right now it's rolling, so that's where it applies the stamp freely, and then movement is smear. You can't really see it in this example, but other examples it will be more obvious. And scale is the size of the grain. So again, you can't really tell with this grain, but if you had something maybe with circles, it would just make that even larger. And the reason why you can't tell with this grain is because it's blank. So if I change this to, let's say, blotch, let's do a different one. Let's go brick. Okay, so we have that there. So if you go back to grain, and you can still can't really see any movement, but you can see here it starts to change a little bit, and that's because it's getting larger and smaller. And zoom is when you can, the grain can zoom with the brush shape. So with this zoom here, or you can just cropped is locked, so it's not going to zoom when you zoom brush shape. Or if you put it all the way up, it'll just follow size, so it'll follow whatever you do. Rotation is the same as what I mentioned for the last rotation. And filtered on applies anti-aliasing, which is smoothing of the edges, similar to Photoshop, whereas if you have it off, it's going to be a little bit more jagged. Dynamics. Fall off is what affects the length of the stroke. So you can see here, even though you may take a stroke that long, it's going to end like a third of the way through. So I generally don't have that on. And then dilution is how much water is in the brush. And this is only available when you have glazed off. And charge is also only available when you have glazed off, and it's how much paint is applied to the brush. If you have glazed on, then you can use a cumulative and flow. Cumulative builds up as the stroke is made, and flow is the amount of paint applied to an area every time the brush moves. Speed. Opacity variance for speed is if you're going to make a brush stroke really fast, then it's going to be a lower opacity. I was slower here, faster here, slower here. So it got smaller when I was faster. And then with opacity, let's turn this all the way up. So you can see where I was slower, it's more solid. But faster, it's more opaque, or less opaque. So for the pencil, pressure, this is the same. So speed, we covered that, so this is now pressure. So the more pressure you have will affect the opacity. So the more pressure I have, it's more opaque. The lighter I am, the more transparent it is. Size, same thing. I'm going light, 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 hard, hard, hard. So tilt will change the angle of the brush. Tilt is how your pencil tilts and how it affects the brush. So it'll affect it with the angle, the opacity, and the size. Generally, I do leave this off. And orient to iPad screen is so that the brush stays the same even if you turn this in a vertical versus a horizontal, like portrait versus landscape, it's still gonna keep the same brush. And then size limits, we have max. This is how the biggest you want the brush to go. So if I only want the brush to go that big, it will not go any bigger no matter how hard I press or how large I make the brush. And same with minimum. I'm allowing the minimum of really, really tiny, but if you go this, then the minimum is that big no matter how light you press. So I like to have full minimum and then usually around somewhere there, if not the most for max. Opacity is the same. I like to allow for all of the different variations of opacity. So the pressure can get you the most color, and then the lightest pressure can get you the least.
So after changing all the settings, you can see that it's turning into somewhat of a brush. It has some characteristics of a brush, but it's still a very square brush, and that's because when we inverted the shape, we made the outside black, which would make the color be on the outside. So that's why it's square. But just to show you, I'm gonna use one of their oval brushes, and you can see that the middle was black, and now it looks more like a regular brush. It has that rounded oval shape. Okay, so we've gone over the settings, which was a lot to go through, I know. So now let's get into making an actual brush. The first thing I'm gonna show for you is the transparencies. So I'm gonna pull up that brush that I made where I overlaid the two brushes and made one more opaque. I'm going to load that in and show you what that does. You can see as I'm drawing around the edges that you have that kind of fuzzy glow, and that's from having a lighter black around the edge. So now I'm going to upload one of the brushes I made that was more of a solid black in a circular shape. I'm going to grab that one. I'm going to clean it up so I don't have any of the different shades of black and white. I want it to be very crisp. I want the brush to be solid black and then the outside to be completely transparent. I'm also going to just clean up around the edges of the brush with my eraser tool. So once I'm done cleaning up, I'm going to go into the layers icon and I'm going to copy that layer. And then I'm going to go back into brushes, click on my shape source, and then click on clipboard to paste that brush that I just copied. As you can see, it's not very black, and that's because the background was transparent because I hadn't merged the white background with the black. There are a few ways to do this. What I did was put them in a group and then clicked on flatten. So I'm just going to copy this layer again and then paste it from clipboard in my brush shape source. And then I'm going to invert it so the black circle is where my paint will be. So now you can see that I have something that looks more like a brush than what we created before. I'm also going to change the grain. This time I'm just going to use something from the Pro Library. I'm going to grab the circular one. And now you can see that it adds a little bit of texture to the edges. And for this next little bit, I'm just going to play around with the settings until I get a brush that I like. So there was a little bit of a sharp edge pointing out in some of my strokes. So I'm going into my original brush again and just softening out one of the edges. And then I'm going to do the same thing, just copy that layer and then paste it back into my brushes. Once you've got a brush you like, you can even go in and kind of optimize it even more. Just use the top preview area, write something that would be actually what you'd be doing in your project, and then just play around with the settings and see how it changes. So that's it. You should be able to create your own brush now. I have some links below to some brushes that I've made if you want to download those, and also an article on my blog to my favorite Procreate brushes that you can find online, so check that out.
Thanks for watching. If you have any questions, leave a comment down below and subscribe for more tutorials.